thanks for joining me on this week's 172nd Air Wing video. Today we've got up for review HobbyMaster's rather beautiful rendition of the long-serving Northrop F-5E Tiger II. This one is in the colors of the Swiss Patrouille Suisse, the aerial demonstration team, and we're going to be covering the model, some of the details of it, and the history of the aircraft in question. What I do on this channel is I will review models in, appropriately enough, 1/72nd scale, and part of the review is a discussion of some of the aircraft's history. And I think this is an important point to get across because fighter jets don't fly solo in real life. In Hollywood and movie portrayals, we're used to seeing the brave hero strap into the jet, press a handful of buttons, and they're off to save the day. But in real life, every fighter sortie is a team effort, and it's a team effort between the people who built the airplane, designed the airplane, serviced the airplane, both people in the military and civilians on the base, as well as the supply chain, the trainers of the pilots, as well as, of course, the people flying them. So the story of even one fighter jet sortie, I should say, is a team effort. And that team effort is unfortunately not always brought across in the popular media that we're used to. So, lacking any other options, I am going to do it here and to pay respects to the stories of the people who make our favorite fighter jets fly, fight, and win. And with that laid out, we're going to talk a little bit about the F-5E's history, which kind of got a bit of an interesting start back during the Cold War. You see, after the end of World War II, the U.S. Navy found themselves with a large fleet of smaller escort aircraft carriers. Now, these aircraft carriers were designed to work with propeller airplanes during World War II. And with the conclusion of the war, these carriers, eminently suitable for use as propeller-borne aircraft carriers, were not necessarily up to snuff for bigger, modern-for-the-time jets, such as the F-4 Phantom II and the A-6 Intruder, among other options coming out at that time. So, spotting an opportunity, the Northrop Company figured that if they designed a lightweight fighter, they would be able to showcase an aircraft that would be able to do the fighter mission, but also be small enough and light enough to operate from these smaller escort-size aircraft carriers. The Northrop Company bet that, like all navies, the U.S. Navy would not willingly reduce its stockpile of ships. In this case, they bet wrong. After development of the N-156 design, the U.S. Navy called Northrop's bluff. After the U.S. Navy retired all of their World War II era escort carriers, less one or two, that left the N-156 lightweight fighter without a mission. Now, the N-156T variant would be picked up by the U.S. Air Force to become the aircraft better known as the T-38. And this airplane was intended to replace the T-33, which itself was a relatively ancient aircraft for its time and was not suitable for teaching Air Force pilots how to fly much faster aircraft, such as their own variant of the F-4 Phantom II and the F-104, as well as the F-100. Note that to this day, the N-156T/T-38 Talon is still in service at the time of this video, marking 68 years of service in the U.S. Air Force as a trainer. Now, there are plans and work in progress to replace the T-38 with the Boeing and Saab Consortium T-7, but that effort has been delayed, and who knows, like many projects of its kind, it may not yet come to fruition, leaving the Northrop T-38 still in service. Note that, among other differences, the distinction between the T-38 and the F-5 is the F-5 is going to have bigger intakes, one seat versus two on the T-38, as well as featuring no leading edge root extension or area between the end of the wing and the front of the fuselage. That section initially added to the F-5 to cover the actuators for the leading edge flaps was found in aerodynamic testing to benefit the airplane's turn and angle of attack capabilities, leading to its inclusion in a lot of designs, such as the F-5's bigger brother, the F-A-18 Hornet series of aircraft, as well as the F-16. Coming back to the adoption of the N-156 design, in 1962, President John F. Kennedy initiated a competition to determine what Western low-cost fighter would take the place on the flight lines of NATO and American allies during the Cold War. This was a competition designed to generate an aircraft that the Western powers could use to counter the affordable and widely proliferated Soviet-built Mikoyan and Gurevich MiG-21. So with that goal in mind, the N-156F variant was picked as the winner of this 1962 FX competition. The N-156F became the F-5A. So the F-5A would go on to be built in over 600 variants. 200 of them would be, 200 F-5Bs would be built in addition to the 600 single-seat F-5As. The F-5Bs are ordered as combat trainers. Canada Air and the Spanish Casa Aerospace Company also built between them nearly another 300 examples of the F-5 A and B design. So this initial variant became unexpectedly successful, and in 1970, Northrop won a contract to design and build a follow-on for the F-5A. The new variant would be called the F-5E, featuring a ANAPG-53 radar, leading-edge root extensions, which I've mentioned earlier, leading-edge slats, and automated slat programming to enhance the turn capability of the aircraft even further to better match the MiG-21, and higher power General Electric J85-21 motors, two of which occupied the aft, quote-unquote, boat tail of the F-5's fuselage. A two-position nose gear, which was originally designed on the Canada Air F-5 variant, was also adapted to fulfill all of the F-5E and F aircraft. And this was done to enhance the takeoff time of the new aircraft. So when the F-5E and F-5F takes off, generally the nose gear is extended to increase the fuselage lift, which was an important enhancement for an aircraft that was designed to be a low-cost point defense fighter for NATO countries facing against the Soviet Union during the Cold War. The first F-5E took to the skies in 1972. Many of them were also produced outside the United States under licensed production. Among other nations, Switzerland built 91 F-5Es and two-seat F-5Fs. Switzerland in the late 1960s found themselves in a position to need to replace their fleet of aging subsonic 1950s era jets. After evaluation of the F-4E Phantom II, the Mirage F-1, and the A-4N Skyhawk, Switzerland decided to choose the F-5E, citing the low cost of ownership, ease of maintenance, and low acquisition price. These attributes helped push the F-5E to the top of the list for the Swiss aerobatic team. The Patrouille Suisse transitioned from their aging Hawker Hunters in 1994 to the F-5E. Now, there's been multiple attempts to retire the aircraft in 2013 and 2016. However, as of 2024, the team is still flying the Northrop F-5E in high style. And if you don't believe me, just scroll back to the intro footage and I'm sure you'll be convinced. So with all that laid out, let's talk a little bit about the look and the setup of the HobbyMaster rendition of the F-5E. So the pros and cons, I usually get to this section because, like all things, myself included, nothing is perfect, right? So the pros, the paint quality of this is really well done. I'm glad to share that the red and the white is on point for the finish, shading, and so forth. The smaller details, such as the Patrouille Suisse insignia on the side of the fuselage, as well as the website here, and the hydraulic access doors, as well as the indicator for the engine, and then the auxiliary intakes, small markings, all of that stuff is done really well. Obviously, the red of the aft anti-collision light pretty much blends in with the rest of the red in the very striking Patrouille Suisse color scheme. However, that's also done really well. And you can't tell necessarily in this shot, but the green and the red anti-collision lights are also rendered very nicely by HobbyMaster on this release. So overall, the paint scheme and the colors, as well as the smaller details, are pretty much bang on and well worth some interesting eye candy and perusal there. The VHF antenna, which you see mounted on the dorsal side of the aircraft, is not only accurate to the real thing, it is an antenna designed to help communicate with civilian frequencies, which is important if you're an aerial demonstration team flying to various airports, some of which will of course be civilian or dual use civilian military airfields. So that is added on the Swiss variants, which have some more modern avionics anyway, not just for communications, but also for weapons employment as well. So it is good to see that here modeled accurately on the F-5E in the Swiss colors. That antenna is not necessarily present on all F-5 variants, so that is a welcome sight on this release. And once again, the color scheme is just, it is beautiful. It really does elevate the F-5's appearance, and even in this video, I don't think I've really done it justice. This Patrouille Suisse color scheme is just striking on this F-5, and I, for one, was really amazed when I opened the box and saw it through the bubble wrap. I mean, it was like, wow, this is a cracking color scheme. And even if you are not necessarily the biggest fan of the F-5 or the T-38, I think one of these definitely deserves to be in your collection, because as cool as this may look in my video, hopefully I've done a good job capturing the model's striking appearance, it looks far better in person. So really well done there. And the other great thing that I'm glad to share about this, which I can't necessarily share with all of my reviews, is that this release is rather affordable. You can pick these up for less than $90 to $95 retail. And when they're on sale, which happens somewhat, periodically, depending on the retailer and who you go through, you could save quite a good penny on this. I think last year I picked this up for about $75 plus shipping and handling plus tax. So all in all, I think it's a really good deal, especially for that price. So with the pros of the model discussed, let's cover some of the cons. The first we'll tackle is the cockpit. The canopy, if you notice here, is more or less level in presentation. When you look at the front of the canopy to the back, it's one smooth arc. That's because I've put a bit of blue tack on the underside of the canopy. So that's done to help align it, because out of the box, it sits a bit flat. So consequently, if you don't put some blue tack on there, it's going to sit a little weird, which is unfortunate. HobbyMaster has a little slot that you put the canopy that you display in the open position on, but there isn't a slot on the closed canopy. And I think that's why it sits a little lower than it should out of the box. Again, small amount of blue tack will fix that issue, and you're not necessarily going to see it unless someone takes a canopy off and shows you. But bear in mind that it is a point to note if you do want to get one of these. Another thing to understand is the with the external fuel tank, which is sometimes fitted for long distance flights, you cannot display this model with the included stand. As with most of my reviews, I'm using a caliber wing stand precisely for this reason, because I can showcase it in flight and not have to worry about obstructions or incompatible stand and accessory configurations. In this case, I'm glad to share that while you can display this model gear down or gear up, you cannot display it with the included extended fuel tank. I believe this is a 150 gallon tank. You can't display it with that and have it displayed in flight with the included stand. So since the stand sits flat to the fuselage, you have to leave the external fuel tank off if you display it in the air, which is unfortunate. That may be a drawback for some of you that have very specific display requirements and setups at wherever you keep your models at. So bear in mind, if you want to display it with the landing gear up and the fuel tank attached to the fuselage, you will need to use an aftermarket fuel tank, or excuse me, an aftermarket stand to showcase this with the fuel tank in flight. And finally, we'll point out, and this is not just an F5 HobbyMaster model thing, but also a general HobbyMaster issue of some of their models, especially the F4. The aft engine nozzles, especially around the afterburner, is like this lackluster gray. That should be more closer in color to more of a reflective titanium, especially for display airplanes where they are, kept in a very clean condition for demonstration and display purposes. So, especially on a release like this, I would hope to see more of a reflective silver back here to kind of echo what the real aircraft looks like instead of this generic flat slate gray business that's going on over here. One of the releases that HobbyMaster came out with recently, I think it was their, the Taiwanese F5F. They actually have a much better patina for the aft engines and the engine afterburner nozzles than what this F5 has. So hopefully HobbyMaster has applied that to their F5s going forward. That would be awesome to see. And hopefully I'll be able to see that in some of their later releases. And finally, the engine intakes. This is a small thing, but I do want to point out that with the engine intakes, when you look down them, you're going to see the paint job of the aircraft instead of a dark finish, because on the actual aircraft, when you look down there, you're not going to see much because the engines are back here. So there's enough of a distance between the front of the intake face and the front of the engines that you're just not going to see anything except a shadow. So that should be black. However, it's body color on the model. It's not a big deal to me personally, but it is something to point out if that is a detail that you might care about. So with that, we will conclude today's review here. Thank you for watching, and those of you who are subscribed, I extend my heartfelt appreciation for showing your support for the channel. If you like this video, click the like button to tell the great algorithm gods appropriately, and consider looking at some of my other videos and subscribing. That way you'll be notified when I release a new video from a model in my collection. All of the videos that you have seen on my channel to this point, and probably for the foreseeable future, are of my own. This is not a retail channel or a channel that is sponsored by a company. So everything that you see is from my collection of models that I, with some gifts accepted, have paid for with my own money. So the opinions and observations you see are based on that accordingly. Once again, I extend my heartfelt appreciation to my subscribers. Hopefully anyone new watching this is considering joining those ranks, and we will catch you in the next video.